people, and also about the suffering that they were enduring, like you two been enduring. He was one of the first people to realize what a terrible, terrible mess was going to ensue in Syria. This, of course, ultimately didn't make any difference when it came to this awful end. So, there are quite a few things that I would like to tease out of this tragic story this evening. And the first, I think, this article is the Jewish Museum, and we're particularly interested in Jewish matters, obviously. And one of the features of this story is that after his capture by ISIS or by some allied group, he made every attempt to conceal his Jewish identity. And various bodies outside Syria also made some attempt to conceal his identity. Of course, it was an impossible thing to do because he was all over the internet, including accounts of his having been in Israel and studied in Israel and so on. But I would just like to ask you, do you think it would have made any difference? And then, do you think that they actually knew? Is there any evidence one way or the other?
I think they knew that he was Israeli.
Use the mic, please.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Being Jewish and being Israeli really two different things. Jews, in my opinion, can travel around and they're not really restricted. Israelis, on the other hand, are. If you have an Israeli passport, you're stuck in the countries. You can have a travel time. So I think by protecting the fact that he was an Israeli, bought him a lot of time. He would have been killed a lot earlier. Being Jewish probably didn't help either, but I don't know if they really know he was a Jew. But if they would have known he was an Israeli,
was that a personal view? Was that a view that you acquired from, I don't know, American diplomats or Israeli officials? Because it might have worked in a completely different way.
You're probably right, but he was missing for 13 months. And obviously, we're worried about the fact that he is. He knew that was probably bad odds against them. So I won't say I investigated that, but I spoke to many people and a few people that have been over there, and they kind of reassured me that by not letting one that it was Israeli, that they probably said something.
Of course, one of the issues, and we'll get to that later, is the extent, is the fact that I think you both felt that the United States didn't do everything that it could have done in these circumstances, and you're rather critical of Obama in this whole story. But as he was also Israeli, and given Israel's kind of history of being prepared to do just about anything to get Israelis back. I wonder whether this had not occurred to you to play the Israel card in that way.
Well, within hours after he was captured, it appeared on the internet that he had been captured for a couple hours, and Israel jumped really quick. And they expunged everything against him. Didn't exist. He went to school in D.C. All his records were expunged. He was never a citizen. And from what I understand, there's quite a few people that were involved with that. That's a pretty big feat to get somebody off the internet or out of Wikipedia or whatever it could be.
told you not to do that?
People with the other guy, people in government, and also someone who traveled with my son, who was with him when he went missing. But he was in third grade. He wasn't aware. So we kept him there for about 8 months.
Yeah,
well. So he kept him there for quite a few months. He was actually doing a lot of investigating and a couple of other journalists that were helping traveling across the border, just find this unit, find any information. And actually, the FBI was called looking for information. Because I was getting information constantly, at least every week I was calling and speaking to this gentleman in Turkey. And the FBI knew that. I do fresh information every day. So it became a habit. They just call me.
Every week.
Yeah.
At the same time.
Right. You have any information for us? I said, yeah, yeah. You're supposed to, you know, you're doing your job. And they said their hands were fine.
Yes.
It's not the same. In saying that, to answer your question, the government and the FBI really always put us on the back burner. Stephen went missing in August, and we got a ransom letter that we received in December, and it was extraordinary. They were asking for $137 million. The country's came for them, and at that point we realized that we weren't alone. That Stephen was retrieved for other Americans. And we started to search out to find who these people were. And finally, the government and the FBI shared with us the other families. So we very quickly formed a bond between all of us because we really only had each other. Because they were getting the same treatment as we were getting. And it was a terrible situation.
Well, this certainly is one of the grave issues here. I think it was only probably about a year before Stephen was captured that the G7 had collectively agreed upon a policy on not negotiating with terrorists and not giving ransoms. And the United States was one of the signatories to that particular G7 agreement. No, this is before the executive order. This is before the executive order. And so there was a kind of consensus, like the United Kingdom, for instance, wouldn't give ransoms. Israel, generally speaking, doesn't give ransoms. And other members of the G7 don't give ransoms, so it would be very difficult for the United States to pay out at this particular point, given their commitment to this collective anti-terrorist policy, in a way. But and I think it's worth just thinking about exceptions to this, because the idea of such a policy is no exceptions, no exceptions. You're going to have a policy, you can't have any exception, it will crumble. Both the Americans and the Israelis, of course, did have exceptions in terms of...
Especially the Israelis.
Well, I think
at least 1,000 people for one person.
Yes, in the case of Shalit, it was over 1,000 people for one person. And in the case of, what's the name, the sergeant who got up? Yes, I mean, he was exchanged for five, I think.
Yes.
Five Hamas. Operatives. So, I mean, did you feel very bitter?
Well, let me say this. Stephen was amongst 26 other prisoners, and which were journalists, and they were from all over. They were from France, and Germany, and Belgium, Spain, and Doctors Without Borders, and every
get to the mic.
And,
everyone but Denmark.
And what was terrible is that Stephen and the other three Americans and the English sat there for 13 months and watched all these people leave and say goodbye to them. And he even wrote about that in a letter that he was able to smuggle out, that he's sitting there watching all these people. You know, what's wrong with the Americans? Why are all these other countries paying for their people and we have to stay here? So, I really feel that given the opportunity, maybe I would be able to save my son by raising him on, but I wasn't able to. We weren't able to do anything because we were probably going to be prosecuted. And also the people that would help us, that would give us funds, would be prosecuted. So
I mean, clearly from the point of view of a father and as a mother, this was a terrible policy. But at the same time,
I was also my daughter, she was right there. She went through
turmoil. I'm sure it was awful for the family. But if we look at the policy as, you know, in slightly more an objective way, not encouraging hostage taking by not paying for hostages and not paying into the treasure chests of groups like ISIS, could be seen as being the only way of dealing with the situation.
Well, in the midst of Stephen being imprisoned, I believe it was May, we had the Sergeant Bobo situation where everybody knows the story, when a woman was missing for, I think, 4 or 5 years, and he volunteered to leave, and he got captured, and we traded 5 terrorists out of equipment for this sergeant that went able. And that, I was very upset about that. We spoke to the FBI and we said, well, the Army in the United States doesn't leave anybody behind. Really? And some is there. And also, there was a trade, I believe, with Ireland, correct, where there was a pallet of money delivered to the airport. And I think there was 5 captives there that were being released. And they were on the plane and they couldn't let the plane take off. So the other plane with the payout of $150 million, or wherever it was delivered. So I don't understand.
But do you think there should be a distinction between the lives of Shalit and Bergdahl? In both cases, there were soldiers. There were soldiers.
I think
in this case, we're speaking of journalists, so should there be a distinction between journalists and soldiers?
Absolutely.
Should journalists have the same rights as soldiers?
The journalists are going to tell the stories of, if it wasn't for Stephen, he wouldn't know about these stories. And
the other situation is you were dealing with culture.
There's always a way to pay something.
A band of bandits and murderers. They were escaped. They were in a bucket. And I think that would have made a difference, or did make a difference. Even today, I mean, there's, I think yesterday there was 5 people that were released from Ireland. The President Trump. Seems like he's been able to do that. He's gotten quite a few people.
He seems to be able to find a way to get everybody else, one way or another, probably under the table. And that's how it should have been done with all the captives that were left there. And I'm sure that's what they do to this day.
And also we found that the people with the FBI that we were dealing with, that were supposedly experts in negotiating, really never came across this type of situation. know, they did a couple kidnappings in Mexico, you know, with the cartels, but the only voices was so
you've been advised, almost instructed, not to have anything to do with the Israelis, and the Israelis have made a big effort to conceal any trace of your son's studies or presence in Israel's Israeli nationality. But did the Israelis from their side make any attempt to get in touch with you or to intervene in any way? Was there any
contact? Never heard anything from Israel until Stephen was brutally murdered. And even then, you know, we got a letter a couple days later from Malcolm and a few other people. And many times I went to Israel, I went to repeat myself, but I was advised and told I wasn't able to do that.
So do you think that they could have done something, if they wanted to do something?
Absolutely.
And why do you think that they did not wish to?
What they wanted was money. That's all they wanted at the beginning. But then it became this big thing, and then James Foley's family went public, and that opened up a whole new can of worms. It was just about money, really it was.
I mean, do you mean from the point of view of ISIS?
Yes.
I'm not speaking about the Israelis.
Well, there was the person that was with Stephen before he was kidnapped. He went and interviewed some of the actors that were released, and one of them drew a map of my memory of where he was, and it was very, very detailed. There was an octagon house, there was a swimming pool, there was a graveyard, and this person who was working with us, within 24 hours, he went on Google Maps, and he was able to get a whole picture of everything, the longitude, the latitude, within 24 hours of getting that picture to me, he gave it to our government, the FBI, and they never did anything there. They knew exactly where they were being. And, you know, there's just so many things that happened. You know, it's just that nobody cared.
But isn't this a CIA? Isn't this one of them?
I don't think we ever met. If we met anybody from the CIA, they never introduced themselves as such. And they normally don't. I mean, you don't know who the CIA is, so. But no.
Seen too many films.
Sure.
But it's very interesting that you were speaking to the FBI on this. Now, inevitably, I'm sure, after Stephen's death, a lot of people inevitably would have said to you, what on earth was a Jew with an Israeli passport doing in Syria? And it's a good question.
Stephen told me that he was always going to tell people that his father was from Chechnya.
From where?
Chechnya. And that he had an Arabic or Muslim background. For some reason, I guess he thought this was kind of protect him. He didn't care about that. You know, he blended in so well, and he was able to communicate with everybody he spoke to. You know, most of the places that he went to, the Jews were kind of accepted. I mean, you know, except for, you know, the Syria area, but he went into Lebanon, he walked around, there was never a problem.
When he was a younger man, was he a sort of fearless type? Did he do dangerous things without getting very scared? Well, he's smiling here.
He was fearless. Yeah.
He was fearless.
He was fearless. He thought he And he did.
Until the end. He really, really did. And he went through a lot of things in all the different countries that he went to. In Egypt, he was pepper sprayed and he was put in jail. And it was always something, and I'm sure that I did not know a lot. He's the guy that knew it all. Everything was kept from Mom. Don't tell Mom.
I know.
But
as
a young kid also, he was the class clown. He'd like to make noise and make sure that everybody saw what he was doing. That was just the way he was. But he also made people laugh, and he was a good-hearted kid.
I believe that just before he was captured, he was in Israel. While he was in Israel, he was there for some friends.
And mentioned to a friend,
a colleague of his, that he'd really had enough of the Middle East, he'd fed up with it, he'd beaten up already by this time, and he was really looking forward to going back to the States on a kind of permanent basis, enough already.
Yes, he wanted to come home.
You were telling him that you had a conversation with him, pleading almost with him not to go into Syria again. What did he tell you?
He said that he's got to do what he's got to do. And that there was just too much there that he had to report on because people weren't reporting anything. His neck was not the governance and what was going on in Syria anymore. It was, he was more concerned about the kids that weren't eating and kids in the hospital and people waiting in parking. He was actually, named the voice of the voices was that he would go in and he would do all these humane stories. I'd like to talk about why he ended up over there, if I could. He was a student at UCF, and he was there for almost 3 years, and he went on the birthright, and he came back from the birthright, and he wasn't going back to school. It was like 2 or 3 days late. And I said, Stephen, do you think you should be on your way back to UCF? And he hesitated. He said, no, I decided that I want to go to school in Israel. So that was a very big surprise. And I said, okay, well, if you want to do that, you're going to have to do that yourself. And he did. It took about 8 or 9 months. And he declared out of law. And I investigated into that world. And I saw that they were going to take him in, they were going to give him health care, they were going to give him a free education, they were going to give him housing, they were going to really start now. And I said, okay, this is a bad thing. So he ends up picking a school, which is ITC in Herzliya, which is the only school he'd have to pay for. So here I am, back to paying tuition again. So, but also he left UCF losing all his credits. He started from zero. He went, started from zero, graduated MIT, the top of his class, and while he was here, he didn't like what he was seeing in the refugee camps and so forth, and he really felt that it was very late and he had a report. And this is what really led him to do the type of reporting that he did.
Well, he certainly had a fairly, great career as a journalist over the last couple of years of his life. Perhaps not. He certainly made a name for himself, and he was on a good trajectory.
Well, he was very good at putting you into the story. When you read his articles, you were there with him. He had a very good knack of really describing what he was able to say. And that's what made him, you know, who he was. That was his drawing.
Excuse me. adventures was a terrible one. And it must have been unspeakable for the family. But since then, you have made an effort to try and extract some good from it through your foundation, which is aimed at offering training to journalists and perhaps others who might find themselves in similar circumstances in different parts of the world. Now, before we go on to talk about that, do you think that the kind of training that you're offering has even added, would that have made any difference?
I don't know for sure, but I think that from the people that we've already trained, all of them have been very receptive and thanking us for giving them the opportunity to have this type of training. I think that maybe probably you would have thought a little bit differently, and you would have weighed out things, and who knows. But that's sort of the reason why we're doing the training now, is because I feel that if you did have this training, you might be here today.
You think so? What specifics?
Maybe he wouldn't have put him in the situation that he was put in.
Perhaps he wouldn't have gone to Syria.
I think he probably would have went to Syria, but maybe he would have had a different set line of security and so forth.
I mean, do you think it's true? It's been suggested that it was his fixer that betrayed him. Do you think that was the case?
We know for sure that he was sold out at the border as soon as he crossed. Somebody called, and within a couple of minutes they had set up a roadblock and they captured him.
Stephen wrote in his letter to us that the gentleman that took him over was not part of giving him up to these people that captured him. And this other friend of his, Barack, also said that he was not part of it. But I believe what Stephen wrote. But it's hard to believe because they were let go, and Stephen was not. But of course, they were Syrian. So who's to know?
Yes, that part of the story must have been very, very difficult to bear. All aspects of the story must have been very difficult to bear, but seeing people being released and going off, and I believe that one of them was Spanish, and I think Spain admitted to having paid ransom $6 million, which was a lot less than $230 million, but still it's quite a sizable sum, so that obviously not.
The gentleman, Mark, was very good friends with Stephen in captivity, and actually he's going to be coming here shortly and we're going to get to meet him, but he couldn't talk to us for a very long time because his country said, do not talk to anybody about this. He doesn't really say that the country paid, but we know that's what happened.
He tried to contact a couple different captives, and each of them were instructed by their countries not to talk to the Americans, not to talk to the families, not to admit that they were innocent. And in Marco's case, it was about 9 months before he sent us a very lengthy email, actually crying within the email that you know, he felt so bad that he wasn't able to talk to us. But he was afraid. They were afraid.
And did he say that a ransom had been paid? Or how do you know the ransom had been paid?
He said he never really admitted. He says his country asked him that he was not allowed to speak to anybody regarding his release. So, but we all know that that's what happened. They paid. I think Spain or
they did pay. Spain paid, yes.
Yeah.
do. And Italy pays, and I think even there was some French as well.
Oh, yeah, France.
That's where the kidnapping
continues. Four journalists that were released.
That's why the kidnapping continues, because ISIS knew in all those countries where they pay. Actually, what happened?
The English and the Americans.
Because they knew what they were up against
before they were even, you know, captured. After they were captured, what were they going to do with them? They were going to let them.
I wonder why he was tipped off. Why did the ISIS Daesh tipped off at the border that he was coming through? What?
I don't think it was ISIS. I think that they were a group of just, we were told, bad guys. And they were sold and traded a couple of times. At least Stephen was. So he probably ended up with maybe three or four different groups.
ISIS wasn't even known at that time. There was no ISIS. This all came about after.
Yeah, nobody heard of ISIS until Stephen appeared on TV, you know, by his neck, that he was the next one to die. And they heard ISIS, and everybody was saying ISIS. Who's ISIS?
Remember, it was the Taliban. We thought it was Taliban, but it wasn't. Whatever it was for bad guys.
Well, I think it would be as a time bearing. I think that one of the things that's come out of this, you know, right or wrongs, what is the right thing to do in circumstances like this? Should a country pay up? Should they ransom their citizens if they have got the means to do so? Or is this counterproductive? Is this simply going to bring about more kidnappings and provide terrorist groups with the money to buy arms and to carry on their dastardly work? It's really one of the main issues here. And I think it might be interesting, with your permission, to open this up to some general discussion. And if anybody would like to say anything about it.